from the studios of ITN, the news with Richard Swallow.
Good morning. Dawn is breaking over a small island at the Spencer family home at Althorp in Northamptonshire, where Diana, Princess of Wales, has been laid to rest. And as the sun rises over London, long queues of people drained of emotion wait their turn to sign the book of condolence at Kensington Palace. The rest of the nation wakes, many with memories of an extraordinary day in their lives and their nation's history. Neil Connery reports.
After a day the nation will never forget, people returned again through the night to Kensington Palace. 7 days after the crash in the Paris underpass which killed Diana, Princess of Wales, they remembered their candle in the wind. In silence, the people sat, reflecting on a day the world had said goodbye to England's Rose.
I never expected to see this amount of people this late at night, still putting flowers down, tying things in the trees, lighting candles. It's just taking my breath away.
I was meant to go to work today, but I started looking at the funeral this morning and I couldn't go.
Downing Street has confirmed that Diana was offered and had accepted a role as a special ambassador for Britain from the Prime Minister just weeks before her death. After the emotion and grief which brought the country together in remembrance, the royal family has now returned to Balmoral. The tribute paid by Diana's brother, Earl Spencer, and in particular his condemnation of the media's treatment of his sister, struck a chord with many. It has been a week of tears and disbelief, but at last the princess's people have said their farewell. Neil Connery, ITN, Kensington Palace.
The princess's final journey began from Kensington Palace at precisely 9:08. Her coffin, draped with a royal standard, was crowned with wreaths, borne upon a gun carriage of the King's Troop Royal Artillery and flanked by men of the Welsh Guards. At St James's Palace, the two young princes, their father, their uncle and their grandfather, joined the cortege for the final mile to Westminster Abbey. The two young boys displaying immense composure and courage. Behind them, a procession 500 strong from those charities closest to the princess's heart. At the Abbey, privileged guests were taking their seats, Imran and Jemima Khan, Tom Hanks and Steven Spielberg, Tom Cruise and Nicole Kidman, Luciano Pavarotti. Outside, a single chime signifying this part of the saddest of journeys was over. The service that followed was immensely moving for the hundreds at Westminster Abbey, the thousands gathered in Hyde Park, and the hundreds of millions watching on television around the world. John Suchet reflects on a service that began with the national anthem and ended with the choir singing, "May flights of angels sing thee to thy rest."
Heads bowed as the coffin was taken down the main aisle. And the choir of Westminster Abbey lifted their voices. On top of the coffin, a simple card from Prince Harry, then a wreath placed by Prince Charles and his sons. The soprano Lynn Dawson sang from Verdi's Requiem. Diana's elder sister, Lady Jane Fellowes, sounding so similar to her, read Time by an unknown author.
Time is too slow for those who wait, too swift for those who fear, too long for those who grieve, too short for those who rejoice. But for those who love, time is eternity.
Love. The Prime Minister, Tony Blair, continued the theme of love by amending the lines on faith, hope, and charity in Corinthians.
Love never faileth. But whether there be prophecies, they shall fail. Whether there be tongues, they shall cease. Whether there be knowledge, it shall vanish away. For we know in part, and we prophesy in part. But when that which is perfect is come, then that which is in part shall be done away. When I was a child, I spake as a child, I understood as a child, I thought as a child. But when I became a man, I put away childish things. For now, we see through a glass darkly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but then shall I know even as also I am known. And now abideth faith, hope, love, these three, but the greatest of these is love.
Goodbye, England's rose, may you ever grow in our hearts. You are the grace that placed yourselves where lives were torn apart. You called out to our country and you whispered to those in pain. Now you belong to heaven and the stars spell out your name. And it seems to me you lived your life like a candle in the wind, never fading with the sunset when the rain set in. And your footsteps will always fall here along England's greenest hills. Your candles burned out long before your legend ever will. Loveliness, we've lost those empty days without your smile. This torch we'll always carry for our nation's golden child. Even though we try, the truth brings us to tears. All our words cannot express the joy you've brought us through the years. And it seems to me you've lived your life like a candle in the wind, never fading with the sunset when the rain set in. Your footsteps will always fall here along England's greenest hills. Your candles burned out long before your legend ever will.
The Princess's brother, Earl Spencer, paid a deeply personal tribute to his sister.
Today is our chance to say thank you for the way you brightened our lives. even though God granted you but half a life. There is a temptation to rush, to canonize your memory. There is no need to do so. You stand tall enough as a human being of unique qualities, not to need to be seen as a saint. Indeed, to sanctify your memory would be to miss out on the very core of your being, your wonderfully mischievous sense of humor with a laugh that bent you double, your joy for life transmitted wherever you took your smile and the sparkle in those unforgettable eyes, your boundless energy which you could barely contain. But your greatest gift was your intuition, and it was a gift you used wisely. This is what underpinned all your other wonderful attributes. And if we look to analyze what it was about you that had such a wide appeal, we find it in your instinctive feel for what was really important in all our lives.
But there was a bitter rebuke for the media and an apparent warning for the royal family.
I don't think she ever understood why her genuinely good intentions were sneered at by the media, why there appeared to be a permanent quest on their behalf to bring her down. It is baffling. My own and only explanation is that genuine goodness is threatening to those at the opposite end of the moral spectrum. It is a point to remember that of all the ironies about Diana, perhaps the greatest was this. A girl given the name of the ancient goddess of hunting was, in the end, the most hunted person of the modern age. She would want us today to pledge ourselves to protecting her beloved boys, William and Harry, from a similar fate. And I do this here, Diana, on your behalf.
We will. And then from Earl Spencer, what amounted to a direct warning to the royal family about the young princes, William and Harry.
And beyond that, on behalf of your mother and sisters, I pledge that we, your blood family, will do all we can to continue the imaginative and loving way in which you are steering these two exceptional young men, so that their souls are not simply immersed by duty and tradition, but can sing openly as you planned. We fully respect the heritage into which they have both been born, and will always respect and encourage them in their royal role. But we, like you, recognize the need for them to experience as many different aspects of life as possible, to arm them spiritually and emotionally for the years ahead. I know you would have expected nothing less from us. William and Harry, we all care desperately for you today. We're all chewed up with sadness at the loss of a woman who wasn't even our mother. How great your suffering is, we cannot even imagine. I would like to end by thanking God for the small mercies he's shown us at this dreadful time, for taking Diana at her most beautiful and radiant, and when she had joy in her private life. Above all, we give thanks for the life of a woman I'm so proud to be able to call my sister, the unique, the complex, the extraordinary and irreplaceable Diana, whose beauty, both internal and external, will never be extinguished from our minds.
There was an instant reaction from the crowds watching in Hyde Park. The applause taken up inside by the congregation. Final act of the funeral service. At midday, the princess's coffin was taken slowly back through the congregation to the west door. for 1 minute, the world paid its last respects in silence.
A minute's silence was a fitting end to the service. Across the country, thousands of people paid their respects. The final journey from the Abbey north to Althorp brought yet another display of the deep affection Diana inspired. The grief-filled silence of the procession on its way to the service was transformed into heartfelt applause and cascades of flowers. Penny Marshall watched the farewell.
All along the route, her passage was strewn with flowers, the hearse showered, a procession no official had orchestrated, no tradition had prescribed. An overwhelming gesture meant for Diana alone. As the procession drew away from the capital, the mourners never diminished, nor did the garlands, nor the sense of loss. Turning towards the M1 at Brent Cross, London was preparing to let its princess go, back to her childhood home in Northamptonshire. It was a scene repeated for 50 miles. Diana, Princess of Wales, was without her family on this section of her final journey northward, but not for a moment was she ever alone.
Those that had attended or watched the service agreed that it had been almost perfect. The great and the good, the ordinary and the unknown, all of them in their way friends of Diana. For one, there had been a moment of particular poignancy.
I heard the applause grow, and it came through the west door, up the aisle, and everybody started applauding within the Abbey, and it made your hair stand on end. It felt like the applause was going all the way up to Diana herself in a coffin.
As the people who had applauded outside the Abbey left in their thousands, they were all discussing the Earl's tribute to his sister.
I think most people around were very surprised that he actually said it. It was almost a direct, if you like, attack on the royal family.
He's entitled to his opinion, but I don't think church was the right place to say it.
As the cortege entered the heart of England en route to Diana's ancestral home at Althorp, the streets once again were filled with people, there to accompany the princess on the last steps to her final resting place. The flowers that had followed Diana all day continued to rain down on her. The grandeur of London, its palaces and Westminster Abbey, seemed far away now. In these country lanes, there was a tranquility and a sense of journey's end. At last, she was at home, away finally from the public gaze, to be buried surrounded only by her closest family. Other news now. Greg Rusedski has become the first British tennis player to reach the US Open final since Fred Perry won there in 1936. The British number one battled to victory against the unseeded Swede Jonna Björkman in a dramatic five-setter. He'll meet Australian Patrick Rafter in today's final. British-born astronaut Michael Foale has returned to Mir after a six-hour walk in outer space with the Russian cosmonaut. They've been trying to repair the station, but only had partial success in repositioning a key solar panel. And that's all from the ITN Morning News team. We leave you with our own goodbye to Diana, Princess of Wales and Queen of Hearts.
Goodbye, England's rose. May you ever grow in our hearts. You were the grace that placed yourselves where lives were torn apart. Goodbye, England's rose. From a country lost without your soul, who missed the wings of your compassion more than you will ever know. And it seems to me you've lived your life like a candle in the wind, never fading with the sunset when the rain set in. And your footsteps will always fall here along England's greenest hills. Your candles burned out long before legend ever will.